Thank you for being a good father. Thank you for being a wonderful king. Lord, we give you praise. We thank you for being a good father. Tonight, Lord, we want to say thank you for your mercies, your goodness, and your kindness. Thank you for being a good father to us. We thank you. We love you. We bless you. Lord, tonight we ask Almighty God that you give us unction to share your word, O Lord, with clarity, that your people might be blessed, that they might know, O God, that truly you are a good father. Almighty God, I pray, O God, that people will receive revelation knowledge tonight, that we, Almighty God, will be taught of the Lord tonight, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Right. Good evening and welcome to the Identity class this morning. My name is Davis Bamigboye, and I just want to welcome you especially to tonight's meetup. All right. So what we're going to do tonight is we are starting a new series. And I want to just, you know, thank you for making it. It's going to be a journey. It's really more like what we already covered in January, which is basically managing life's transition. But tonight we're just going to be looking at what is our responsibility, you know, in managing life's transition, or what's our responsibility in being able to go from where we are to where God has called us to be. All right. So today's message really is really about going from here to a place called there, to a place called there. All right. Going from here to a place called there. All right. So essentially what I want, I'm going to start off from is this, is the fact that God always calls us to a place called there. God always calls us to a place called there. Where you are now is too small for you. God's vision for you and God's vision for me is bigger and more than you can think. Our thinking, therefore, needs to be broadened. Our vision needs to be expanded. Our goals need to be enormous. Our priorities need to be higher. We are called to take over the nations. We are destined for greatness. We are children of God. We are the ones that the Bible says we are no ordinary people. That's why the Bible calls us a royal priesthood, a holy nation. All right, so that's who we are. Now, but it's amazing though, and slightly frustrating actually, that when we look at the life of a believer at times, we seem to perform lower than you know expected of us. You know, and I don't this is something I'm working through myself. You know, the reason why, you know, we're not really getting to the place where God has in store for us. You know, if you look at the children of Israel, right? The Bible makes us to understand that the journey from the crossing of the Red Sea to the entering to Canaan is actually 11 days. But it took them, you know, 40 years wandering in the wilderness. Now, the wandering, you would think, is caused by God. No, it's not caused by God. Now, if God ordained for them to move from the edge of the Red Sea to the crossing or to get into Canaan, 11 days, which means it's calling them from here to a place called there. But it took them 40 years to get into a place called there. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that the whole lot of them that went into survey the land that came back with bad report, only two people were left alive. The rest of them died in the wilderness. You know, the Bible says that from people who were from age 20 and above, they died in the wilderness, which means for 40 years, they kept going around and round and round and round the same mountain. I bring a word this evening actually to you to encourage you that you may have been going around and round and round the same mountain for so long. The word of the Lord to you tonight is it's time now to keep moving forward. It's time now to keep making plans. It's time now to keep taking action. It's time now to keep moving to where He has ordained for you to go. So we don't want to be like the children of Israel. We don't be like the children of Israel who took a longer time to get to where God has already ordained for them. Yeah, because we have a call, we have a destiny on our lives, you know. But if we allow ourselves to be deceived into thinking wrong thoughts, if you allow yourself to be deceived into thinking that God is the one who is holding us there, if you allow yourself to get into a thought pattern that says God is going to do it, forgetting the fact that God has already done it, And if you get into any of this erroneous thought pattern, we are going to be taken captive by the enemy. We're going to become deceived, you know, by our thought process. Our perception of life will therefore not become the reality that God has in store for us. God's reality is the same thing as God's glory. And in the book of John chapter 17, we did see there that in verse 24, that Jesus Christ said, "The glory that you have given to me, I have given to them," which means the way you see me, the reality that you have for me is what I also have for them. So we don't want to be like the children of Israel that sort of circle around the same mountain for years and years and years. It's like on a treadmill. We're running on a treadmill, but we're not making a lot of progress. So tonight, even as we share the scripture, as we go into the scripture, the thing that I want you to also look at is to understand that, you know, God is always there waiting for us to make a decision. And God is always waiting for us to keep listening to what he has to say. God has plans, purposes for you and I at different phases of our lives. See, if you are going through a challenge right now, I want you to know equivocally that it's not God causing you a problem. I mean, God might take you to a journey, you know, a journey of faith, a journey of test, but God never does evil. God never does evil. As part of the training process, God doesn't train you with calamity. God doesn't train you with penury. God doesn't train you with not good enough, not up to scratch. God's desire, God's plan for you and I is to live a life that glorifies him. And therefore, when we think about what the Bible says in Romans chapter 2, verse 4, the Bible says that it is the goodness of the Lord. Verse 14, sorry, is the goodness of the Lord that leads to repentance. So God is good. God is always good, and God will always be good. All right. So that's the first fundamental principle, really, to bear in mind that in our walk with the Lord, we must know that God is always good. Now, as we move from a place where we are now to a place called there, it's important to know that the thoughts and the plans of God towards you and I, they are always good. So our perception of God, therefore, is very important. Our perception of God must be in alignment with the reality of God for our lives. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, the Bible says that when we behold Jesus, when we behold God in the world, we are transformed to the same image of God from glory to glory. Now, if you think about that passage, it's talking about the fact that, you know, when we look at God the way he is, we see ourselves in him, and we're transformed to the same image of God that we have. As a matter of fact, let's read that scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. There's something profound that I find out actually in life as I began to grow up. It's about the fact that we are limited by the perception of life that we carry. You see, perception is a dangerous thing. Perception, controls your life. Perception makes you see life in a particular way. Perception is what makes you to see life in a way that is contrary to what God has already shown you. You see, in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18 here, the Bible says, "But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." Now, think about that for a moment. Look at what it says. It says, "But we all with unveiled face." We all, who has got the veil from our eyes removed, yeah? The blinkers have been removed so that we can see properly. So we all with unveiled face, we behold, we look in a mirror. Okay, now think about it. You behold yourself in a mirror. There is a reflection that you see from the mirror. So when you look in the mirror, there's a reflection that comes back to you that is actually what you are seeing. So you don't know the way your face looks until there's a reflection that's being brought back to you. So he's saying here now, but when the veil that covers our eyes has been removed, we will look in the mirror and we will behold the glory of God. That's the first thing we'll behold. We will behold the glory of God, which means we will see the reality of God first. But it doesn't stop there. We are also changed. Now, that word change is the word metamorpho, which means to be transformed. It's like when you have a cocoon transform into a butterfly. Is a gradual process of shedding the old weight and coming into new nature. So it says now, but we all with unveiled face, now we behold in the mirror the glory of God, the reality of God, and then we are changed into the same image. We become like we will be old. we become like we'll be old. So we then become, we change into this image of God, but not just from glory to glory. We change from one view of God to another view of God, and by enabled by the Spirit of God. So when we talk about the power of perception as it relates to where we're moving from where we are to where we need to go, we must understand that our perception of reality must be in alignment with the perception of reality that God already ordained. When I begin to believe a lie, when I begin to believe that God is not doing enough for me, when I believe that God has abandoned me, when I believe that God is there in heaven, but he hasn't done anything with my case, when I believe that I'm waiting on God, but God hasn't shown up yet, when I believe that, things are all against me because of where I came from, when I believe that I'm limited in life because of the color of my skin, when I have thought pattern that I've accepted, even as a believer, those things will form a perception that begins to slow me down, that begins not to make me to really live the life that God has done for me. So having a false reality, a reality that is not based on the truth of God, is what we call the false reality. And this false reality comes through, primarily through a thought pattern. A thought pattern. That's where it came from. So here the Bible says that we become who we behold. So the question tonight is, as you're moving from here to a place called there, who do we behold in our journey? Who do we behold on your journey? The goal that God has given you, the vision that God has given you, who are you beholding? Who are you looking on? You see, because our thinking, the way we see God, is what limits our reality of God. In Psalm 78, verse 41, the Bible says that the children of Israel, they limited the Holy One of Israel. So even in our day and age, even though we are new covenant believers, we also can limit God by the way we think. That's why Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says that we should renew our mind. We should renew our mind. We should transform by renewing our mind. We should allow our mind to be renewed, to be metamorphosed, to be changed, even as we look at God from the reality of Jesus. So therefore, if I want to know who God is, I must first of all look at Jesus. If I want to know whether God is a good God, I must look at Jesus, what he did, how he related with people, how he talked to people, how he even hungered around sinners. That is what I must look at, because the view of God that I see is the view of God that I receive. If I think God is vindictive, judgmental, that is what I am going to get. So tonight, even as we begin to delve deep into how do you move from here to a place called there, we need to begin to think about how do we also align our thinking to what God has done. So if we don't align our thoughts to what God has done, what we eventually do is, when things are not going well in our lives, we begin to put God on trial. We judge God. We put him on trial. We begin to say, God, if you love me, this X, Y, and Z should not be happening. That's what we do. And then when we put God on trial, and we will say, Lord, I'm waiting on you. You haven't done this yet. Why haven't you moved in my life? What more can I do to get this? What more can I do to get that? The truth of the matter is that in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, the Bible says that all of the promises of God, they have been fulfilled in Jesus. So God already did everything he needs to do for you. He already did everything he needs to do for me. All right. So it's important to know that even as you move from where you are to where you need to go, to where God has shown you, God desires that you perform more than what you are performing, that you and I perform more than what you perform. None of us is ever going to the state where we are so self-fulfilling, we are so fulfilled that we've been able to glean out all of the resources of God. God wants you and I in 2017 to think big. To think big. Tonight, I'm here, I've come here to challenge us, to challenge myself. That 2017, we have to think big. We have to take and break the boundaries. We have to break the boundaries that hold us bound in our mind. We have to break the boundaries that hold us bound in our thought pattern. We have to break free, from things that has held us bound for many years. That says you only have to go round this the same space over and over again. No, the devil is a liar. The end is come. As you begin to open up your heart tonight, you begin to realize that the King of Kings, his heart is aching for you to possess the gates of the enemy. His heart is aching for you to take nations for the Lord Jesus. So now God is reaching out to you. He's reaching out to you and I. He's hoping that we'll wake up from the stupor of decadence. He's hoping that we'll wake up to a new reality, to his reality. He's hoping that daily that we realize that we are royalty, that we are children of God, that we are king, the sons and daughters of the king, and that we will walk as such. Oh, the king is waiting for us all to come to the manifestations of the sons of God. The Bible says that the whole world is waiting for us as well to manifest. So tonight, as we go from here to the place called there, the thought pattern is we want to manifest the glory of God. God is waiting that one day who will grow up to be like our elder brother, Jesus Christ. God is hoping that one day, is hopeful that one day you and I will take the nations for Jesus Christ. God never gives up. God never gives up. He believes that we are capable of more than we think we are capable. Tonight, as we share and as we look at how God has called you and I, a people of ordinary means, to do extraordinary stuff, we can then begin to think like that we can do it. We can begin to see that it is possible. God's power is not limited by your inadequacies. God's power is not limited by what you think of yourself. God's power, you know, cannot be thwarted. You have greatness living inside of you. You have greatness living inside of you. I want to reach out tonight. Reach out to the lifeline. Reach out to the lifeline. Cross the canyon of life. Get straight ahead. Because the open spaces in the place that is called there is just within reach. So as we start tonight, we're going to look at the life of Elijah. So during this week, I've just been studying, you know, about Elijah. I've studied about, you know, in the book of 1 Kings, I believe, you know, Elijah here is someone that has done amazing stuff. You know, when we look at Elijah, you know, and we look at what he's done for the Lord, and we look at the fact that the Lord used him greatly, we can rest assured that because Elijah is just like you and I, you know, we can operate even in greater level. As a matter of fact, because we're children of God, because we have, you know, we are under the new covenant, because we have Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we are meant to do more than that. All right? We're meant to do more than that. Now, the Bible started Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 17. The Bible says, "And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitant of Gilead, said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Get thee from here," I want you to underline that in your Bible, "get thee from here, and turn thee eastward, and hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is before the Jordan. And it shall be that you shall drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there." I want you to underline there now. So get thee from here, and there is a feeding thee there. So he went and hid and did according unto the word of the Lord. For he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, which is before the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. Praise God. Praise God. So here we see the story of Elijah. We see therefore that there's a place called there for Elijah. Now in this scripture, even as we go further, we realize that the place called there for Elijah keep changing from one place to another. Because if you read in verse 8, the Bible says, after the brook dried up now, the Bible says, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, 1 Kings 17, 8 now, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belonged to Sidon, and dwell there. That's another there. Dwell in where? Sidon. Dwell in Zarephath, which belonged to Sidon. And behold, I have commanded a widow there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow was there. The widow was there, not a widow. The widow was there, gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray you, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring me, I pray you, a morsel of bread in your hand. And she said, as the Lord your God lives, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks, that I may go in and prepare it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as you have said, but make me of it a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and afterward make for thee and for your son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not be used up, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, unto the day that the Lord sends rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her son and her house did eat for many days. And the barrel of meal was not used up, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. So that is the background to going from here to a place called there. So the first place that's called there for Elijah here was the brook Cherith. The brook Cherith. A brook is a place where there's water. A brook is a place where there's water. A brook is a place where there's abundance. A brook is a place where, you know, you have a flowing river. A brook is not a lake. A brook is not a pond, sorry. A brook is not a pond, all right? Things are not really moving there. A brook really is a place where there is abundance. There's a flowing river that just keep moving. So, therefore, when we talk about going to the brook, we're talking about a place where God's supply is. So God said to him, because there will not be rain now, because there will be scarcity now, God made provision for Elijah in a place where there is flowing water, which means that in the flowing water, he has something that he can drink regularly. He has clean water to drink. So God made provision for him in a place where there's flowing water. It's very important to look at this in this context. On the one hand, a nation is going to be going through drought because there will not be any rain at all. But because of that proclamation that there was not going to be any rain at all, God made available eastward of where there would not be any rain, a brook, which is before the Jordan. Now, look at the way the Bible says it. It says, get thee, verse 3 now, 1 Kings 17:3, get thee from here and turn thee eastward and hide yourself by the brook, Cherith, which is before the Jordan. So when it says, hide yourself by the brook, it means the brook is in a place where, obviously, it's not like a common place. Hide yourself, you know, by the brook. Find a brook called Cherith and hide yourself there, which is before the Jordan. So God made provision for Elijah, even in a place where there's scarcity. You might be in a nation today where there's scarcity. You might be in a nation today where there seems to be panic. You might be in a nation today or in a place today where in the natural things do not look like they are going to get better. I'm here to tell you that if you will hear the word of the Lord, if you hearken to his word, God makes provision for you even in a place where there's drought. You know, the people might be going through challenges, but God finds a way to get to you. Now, even if you've made a mistake, God finds a way to get to you. Elijah made proclamation here, and the Bible says, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying. So, therefore, the ability for Elijah to move from where he is to where God wants to show him is predicated on him hearing from the Lord. So, and the word of the Lord came to him, saying. Now, in the book of John, chapter 1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. If you take that context, it seems to me, it says, and Jesus came to him, saying. It's like Jesus Christ is talking to him now. Now, think about it for a moment. Today, we have the fullness of the Godhead living inside of us. We have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit living inside of us, which means you can also say, the Holy Spirit came unto him, saying. Or you could say, the Holy Spirit told you to do X, Y, and Z, saying. Do X, Y, and Z. You know, and therefore, and God can use anything to tell us information. God can use TV that you're watching to tell you information. God can use a dream. God can use a vision. God can use the Bible. God can use, prophecy from somebody. God can use anything to tell you something. The key thing is, are we hearing? what he is saying. Because when the word of the Lord came unto him, the word of the Lord came to him, and the word of the Lord said something to him. So it is therefore predicated upon him being able to hear properly. So that's the key thing first, is that in order for me to go from here to a place called there, I need to hear from God first. But the place called there for me and the place called there for you are different. Okay? Why? Because our callings in lives are different. Okay? So, but the key thing is that God wants you to expand your tent. God wants you to expand your vision. God wants you to look bigger, look at things bigger. God wants you to have an expanded vision. God wants you to look at things in a way that will blow your mind. That's why the Bible says the eyes have not seen and ears have not heard. It has not entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those who love him. You know, God has prepared those things for you. He has prepared those things, the things that eyes have not seen, the things that ears have not heard, the things that has not been conceived by the heart of man, which shows you the magnitude of the love of God, the magnitude of the desires of God, the magnitude of the grace of God, the magnitude of the desires of God for you. God wants you to succeed, brother. God wants you to succeed, sister. God wants you to get to a level where you transcend every realm. You know, God wants you to be someone who is so successful now, you know, who represent him very well, that people will look at you and say, I want to know the God that you serve. Now, when I talk about success, I'm not talking about, you know, just having money in the bank account. That's okay. I'm talking about where you are following what God has called you to do, and you are doing extremely well there. That is what God desires for you. So now, Elijah got a word from the Lord, and the word of the Lord said, move from where you are to where you need to be. I have prepared a place for you in Cherith, in a place that is a brooky place, in a place where water flows, in a place where things are fresh. I prepared a place for you. You know, you are moving from drought now to abundance. You are moving from a place where you don't have enough to more than enough. He said, but the key thing is predicated upon him hearing first. Now, but look at the next thing that happened. Now, because in verse 5, the Bible says, so he went and did according to the word of the Lord, which means the second point is we must obey when we hear the word. So the first thing is I must hear. I must have the ear that hears. I must have my ear must be paying attention, listening attentive to what the Lord has to say in this season. What is the Lord telling me in this season? Or am I being in my season of life now? What is it telling me? Am I be going on a journey now? What is it telling me? So in every season of life, I must be listening to hear the command of the Lord. What's the Lord telling me right now? That's number one. Number two is that I must obey what the Lord has told me. I must take action, you know, to follow through what he's told me. Why? Because in the place called there, that's where my provision is. But in order for me to get from where I am to where I need to be, from where I am now to the place called there, I must of a necessity listen to what he has to say. I must of a necessity act upon what he has told me. So in verse 4, the Bible says, and it shall be that you shall drink of the brook. See, God says, drink of the brook, drink of the flowing water. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. If anyone believes on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. So now he says, you will drink of the brook. But God didn't stop there. He says, but I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. You know, this is what I was pondering on it some months back. I was just pondering on, how did God speak to the raven? How did God Almighty speak to the raven? You know, is it that the raven is just flying? And now it says, I've commanded the ravens, not just one, you know, multiple ravens. Maybe there's a herd of ravens, you know, they were feeding around the brook. Or they might even have been in, you know, who knows, you know, 5 miles away. And God's, you know, these guys woke up one day. And you heard the voice of the Lord that says, hey, they're raven. Hello, raven. And God will call them by their name. Maybe one is George. Maybe one is, who knows? I don't know. Maybe God calls them by their name anyway. Calls a raven by the name and say, hey, you know, go to location 555, longitude 555, and latitude X, Y, and Z. And, you know, go and you'll find a man there and feed him. Get him all the food that he needs. This is God talking. Now, if God could talk to a donkey, you know, in the story of Balak and Balaam, If God can talk to a donkey, God surely can talk to a raven. Now, let's take this to the next level. What is it? What is it that you want in life that you're thinking, nobody can help me? Nobody can help me. It's not going to work. I have nobody here to help me. You might have been like that man that Jesus Christ wanted to help. And he says, when the angel troubled the water, alas, there was nobody to help me. Jesus Christ said, what can I do for you? What should I do for you? What do you need? Instead of him to say, look, I need my healing. He says, oh, you know what? When the enemy troubles the water, when the angels troubled the water, I had no one to carry me. He got into excuses. Instead of saying, Lord, I need miracle. You might be on the call tonight. You might be thinking, based on the vision that God has shown you in the place called there. And you might be thinking, is this ever going to work? I don't know nobody. I don't have any help. I'm a single parent. Nobody's going to help me. No one to come through. So I'm packing this vision now. I'm putting it in a box. I'm forgetting about it. It's never going to work. That might have been the thought pattern that's going through your mind. That may have been the thought pattern that's gone through your mind for so many years. Just like the children of Israel, going around upon the same mountain but not making progress. Tonight, God has sent me to tell you, if he can speak to the ravens, if he can speak to the donkey, he can surely speak to those things to bring you help. When God places a vision in your heart, every resource you need for that vision has been released. God does not release a vision in your heart that he hasn't provided for. Don't carry the burden on your head and say, hey, you know what, until I walk it, God is not going to walk it. God has asked me to tell you, if I command the ravens, I surely can handle the challenges that you face. So God now commanded the ravens to say, go and feed Elijah there. The place called there here is the brook Cherith. So the ravens now fly there. I'm just trying to paint the picture here. The ravens fly there. And here they saw Elijah having obeyed the word of the Lord. And Elijah was just only drinking water in the brook. And morning one, flesh landed beside Elijah while he was still sleeping. Woke up, took the flesh and ate it. In the night, they brought, the Bible says that they brought in bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. So this guy ate bread and flesh in the morning, bread and flesh in the evening, and he had water to drink from the brook. So the ravens keep bringing bread every morning, keep bringing flesh every morning and every night without fail. What did the ravens do to bring the flesh? They must have gone there to slaughter the flesh. They must have gone there to kill the flesh. They are just carrying out the instruction of the Lord. Get bread, get flesh. Where did they get bread from? I don't know. I don't know where they got the bread from. But the provision was made available. They went to pick it and they fed Elijah. What are you believing God for this year that you're thinking is not possible? God is sending me to tell you tonight, if you can believe, all things are possible to them that believe. Don't think it's over. It's not over. It's not over. I want you to hold on to your vision. Hold on to the vision that God has shown you. Don't give up. It's going to be all right. The ravens have been sent to feed you. Christ, when he died, he obtained the promises already. You are not begging God to give you something. He already made the provision for you before you got here. The vision that God is placing in your heart, that vision is for an appointed time. That vision is provisioned by God. God has made the provision available for the vision he has given you. So don't start getting to the point where you start thinking, oh, unless I walk, it is not going to work. God is asking to tell you tonight that at the brook Cherith, there is the brook there, the water flows. At the brook Cherith, this man Elijah got fed by the ravens, morning and night with bread and flesh. And therefore, God, if God can feed Elijah using the ravens to feed Elijah, it can surely raise somebody up that you don't even know to send help to you. But what is your responsibility? What is my responsibility in this matter? We must, of a necessity, pay attention to what the word of the Lord is saying. Number two, we must take action. If you look in Elijah's case here, number one, he had the word of the Lord in verse 4. Number two, what did he do in verse 5? He went and did according to the word of the Lord. He went and did according to the word of the Lord. Why? Because he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, which is before the Jordan. His job is to go and live by the brook. And is therefore expected to expect that the ravens will feed him. So that brings us to number three. From moving to a place where we are here, to a place called there, we must have expectation. The question I want to ask you tonight is, my friends, what are you expecting? You know, when in the UK here, when it is flu season, or when there is some time when the pollen comes out of the hair, people start talking about, you know, it's pollen time, you know, and therefore they go buy the medicine for it, they go prepare for it. So there's an expectation that pollen is coming and therefore I'm going to get it. Therefore, because we expect and prepare for negativity, we still draw negativity over our lives, even though that's not the heart of God for us. The question right now is the vision in your heart from where you are to where you are going in the future. Have you made provision for that? Are you expecting it to work out or not? What is the expectation that is going through your heart? Because see, the expectation of the righteous, the Bible shall not be cut off. So your expectation actually determines what you receive. Expectation is the same thing as to be expectant. To be expectant is to be filled with expectancy. Now, expectancy means to expect and see, which means that when you expect something to come, you therefore behold it, you see it. So it is what we expect that we attract upon our lives. That again really goes back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, that says, we become who or what we behold. So Elijah here now went and did according to the word of the Lord. For he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, which is before the Jordan. So now he went to before the Jordan, he just went to dwell there. He was expecting the ravens to come. And the ravens did come. Why? Because he that promised is not a man that I will lie, neither is this the son of man that will repent. Whatever he has promised, he is more than able to bring it to pass. So the ravens brought him bread now, and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. So now the drought experience has been averted now, because even though the whole nation are going to go through drought, Elijah now has escaped and is now living in a place of abundance. He has his needs met. What needs do you have, brothers and sisters? What needs do you have that you think, hey, God cannot meet that one? You know, I better go find somebody else. No, I'm trying to tell you that the needs you have, God has already made provision for it. Now, if you also look in this case that that Elijah was not the one that begged God for God to make the provision. God made the provision by his grace. Elijah took action to possess what God has already made available. And this is very important, because at times we can get into error where we think, oh, I have to make God do something. No, everything you've ever received, everything that I've ever received, is because God, by grace, moved to provide them for us. And then we just reach out our hands to receive them. Right. So therefore, it's important to know that it is not by what you do. What you do is important, but it's not by what you do that you get it. You know, last week, the Lord laid a passage in my heart that's really important. I think that's in Proverbs chapter 21. I think it's verse 18, I believe. Let me actually get it out. And it was talking about the fact that, you know, that the horses are prepared for the day of battle, but victory is of the Lord. Victory is of the Lord, yeah. Which means that Proverbs chapter 21, verse 31. You know, it says 21:31, right? Proverbs 21:31 says the horse is prepared for the day of battle, but safety is from the Lord. Another translation says, victory is of the Lord, which means that there is a bit that I have to prepare for, but the victory that I receive is actually from God. God is the one who crowns my effort with victory, but I cannot sit down and say, hey, God is going to bring it. Let me not do anything. No, that's not what we're saying here. We're saying that in the case of Elijah, God already made the provision available before Elijah had the need. It's the same thing with Jesus. You know, Jesus Christ made all of the provision you need, you ever need, available before you became born again. You see, the healing of the world, the salvation of the world, the prosperity of the world, everything has already been bought for by the blood of Jesus. But we have to, what, lay hold and appropriate it. So in moving from a place where we are here to a place called there, it is important that I understand what is my responsibility. What do I need to do? What is that which God expects me to do? And what is that which God expects me to know that he has already provided? When therefore I look at that in the context of the new covenant, we see that God has already made provision available for everything I ever need. In the book of Luke chapter 11, the Bible was talking about, you know, how we provide for our children. And he was using that to, as a comparison, you know, with God. And he was saying that in Luke chapter 11, I believe it's in verse 33, Luke 11. Give me one moment here. Luke 11:11. The Bible says that if a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will you give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he ask an egg, will you offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? So here we see that God gives the Holy Spirit to them, to those that ask him, right? But the provision has already been made available. The provision is not coming just because when you ask it, that's when God is just creating it. God already made that provision available for you before you have the need. That is amazing. Which means that what is it that you're looking for right now? God has made the provision available for you before you have the need. When God shows you the vision of what he wants you to do, do you know that God has made that provision available before you have the need? When you start having a desire in your heart about something that you want to do, do you know that the provision is already available for you before you have the need? Why? Because if you can think for your children while they are still sleeping and thinking about what you want to do for them, you want them to go to Harvard, you want them to go to MIT and all of these big schools, and you're thinking about it for them, even when they were still babies at 5 years old or 6 years old, you're thinking about it for them. He says, how much more, if you can think about that, how much more God? That God has already made everything available for us before we ever got on the scene. God made everything available. So when a thought is coming to your heart, when the vision is being birthed in your heart, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that God already made the provision available for that vision before it came to you. God is not scratching his head now and say, hey, how will I fund this project? No, God already made the provision available before you got there. But there is a responsibility on my part to do what? To act and take action. All right. So now we go back to 1 Kings chapter 17 now, and we look at the fact that, you know, Elijah now went to the brook Cherith, waited. The ravens came in verse 6. They brought bread and flesh in the morning, bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. Okay. So now Elijah is, number one, listen to the word of the Lord. Number two, Elijah went to the brook where God has made provision available. Okay. Number three, Elijah expected God to perform what he said he would do. So there is a power of expectation, right? And now number four, Elijah is partaking of the blessing. Period. That's very good, right? Going from there, from here to a place called there. God says, I want you to leave from here now. When you've just spoken to Ahab, I want you to go to a place called there, which is the brook Cherith before the Jordan. Now, you will think that because Elijah is in the place called there, there will not be challenges. And that's where I want to also go to now. God may be calling you to a new vision. God may be calling you to a new life. God may be giving a birthing a vision in your heart that's so big, so great. Never expect that you are going to possess the land without opposition. Never expect that you're going to get to the place where God has ordained for you without challenges. You see, there's no way you can get to where God has ordained for you without some challenges along the way. But do the challenges make us to feel that God has abandoned us? No. It is when we go through those challenges that we must always remember that because God gave the vision, because He birthed the vision in my heart, right, He is responsible on His part to fulfill it. Now, the amazing thing, though, is that God has already fulfilled all of the things we need Him to fulfill in our lives, even before we have those needs. Therefore, what is my responsibility? My responsibility is to renew my mind, to believe that God is always there and will always be there, and God will not change His mind according to what He has given me to do. My job now is to respond. My job now is to respond, is to begin to think of how can I take it to the next level? How can I ensure that the thing that the Lord has in store for me, I can possess it? So when I think about this, I think about the fact that even though I'm moving from here to a place called there, God is the one who has brought me to the place I am. So like Elijah now, he begins to eat out of what the ravens were feeding him. He begins to enjoy the life that God has ordained for him. But you would think that there would not be a problem. But that is where we can go wrong at times, because the problem can come in the place of provision. The problem comes in the place of provision where we see that although God has made the provision available, you know, the things can still dry up. So the brook dried up. But remember, even though the brook dried up, what hasn't finished is that the ravens can still be bringing the food. They can still be bringing the bread, but the brook has dried up. So in verse 7 now, we see that the Bible says, and it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Oh, I wonder. So the rain now has not been in the land for many years, and the brook ultimately had to dry up. Now, you would think that God has abandoned him. No. The Bible says in verse 8, and the word of the Lord came unto him again, saying, arise now, get thee, go. So here's the thing, right? Before the Lord made that command, the brook didn't dry up one day. The brook would have been drying up bit by bit by bit by bit. And Elijah will be saying, well, because the Lord has told me to stay here, I'm going to stay here until the Lord told me otherwise. I can imagine if you were in that position, God placing you in a place where the brook is flowing with water. God placed you in a place where things are doing well because it's called you into a destiny. It's called you into a vision now. Things are going well for you. But all of a sudden, things start to dry up a bit. You start to wonder, has God left me? What have I done wrong? You know, when you start asking that question, you miss the point. The point is God has told him, he's in communion with God and he's listening, he's hearing what the Lord has to say, right? So now the brook is drying. He never panicked. He just kept thinking, well, God will come through. God will come through. It's amazing to me, though, that the brook dried up before the Lord spoke the word. Wow, that is mind-blowing. The brook dried up completely, then God spoke. Why did God do that? Why did God have to wait until the brook dried up before he spoke? Well, beloved, the truth of the matter is, you see, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. If Elijah had left before the brook dried, if Elijah had left before God spoke, Elijah may have died, even though he's got a great calling of God upon his life. Why? Because he did not wait for direction from the one who gave the first direction. Because God has not spoken, you need to stay where God has told you. If he has not spoken, you need to stay there. You need to stay there until God spoke. Don't move. You see, because every time we move, when God has not spoken, we subject ourselves to a lot of pain. This morning, you know, when I was driving, I was just thinking about, you know, my journey last year and what, you know, all the different things that have been going on. And I sort of thought, what is the motive behind some decision I made? And I said, wow, it might be that, you know, when I think about it deeply, God hasn't actually asked me to do some things like in my business. And that's why the reason maybe, you know, things were a bit of a challenge, you know, and it could be the pangs of building a new business. Who knows? I mean, I just got to go back into my heart and check and say, what was the motive really behind this thing that I did? But the key thing here is that if the Lord is leading you, the Lord will always make a way. Look, even when you make mistake, even when you've blown it, you know, there some of you on the call tonight or some of you watching on Facebook, and you might have thought, oh, I blew it. I really blew it in my life. You know, I just made a mistake last year. I made a mistake 2 years ago. It's because of something that happened to me when I was 12 years old or 15 years old or 17 years old or 20 years old. That's why my life is like this, topsy-turvy, you know, things are not working. I'm here to tell you, quit looking to the past. The past will never help you. The past will not encourage you. The past will not take you to where God has in store for you. God has a purpose and a destiny for you. And that is what you need to focus on. You need to keep thinking of what is God saying next? What is God saying now? Now, that is the heartbeat of God. God wants you and I to be so intimate with Him that we can hear His heartbeat, that we can hear what He's saying at every season of life, that we can know that God is also still speaking to us. So now in verse 8, 1 Kings 17, 8 now, we see that the Bible says, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise, stand up, wake up, get thee to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. That's another there. The there now has changed. Okay, the drought now has come to where you are. You know, the world has been going through challenges all over the place, but you have been protected. Now, all of a sudden, the pangs is coming to you. Okay, because trade is not happening as it should. The pangs is not getting to your business. God now says, gives you a new vision, gives you a new idea. I said, now, let's go to this side. Why? Because I have commanded, again, a widow there to sustain you. Now, this is mind-blowing. How could God choose a widow? You see, the Bible says God uses those things that are innocuous, those things that are not appropriate, those things that are seemingly so weak, so beggarly things of this world to confound the wise. You know, God chooses the things that, you know, people don't reckon with, you know, and God uses those things as instrument of warfare, as instrument of His glory. That's the reason why the call of God upon your life, you don't qualify for it. You know, the blessings that God is bringing your way, you don't qualify for it. The things that God has called you to do, you don't qualify for it. If you think you qualify for it, then you have shortchanged yourself. See, God puts a gift. God puts Himself in a body of clay. Can you think about that for a moment? The Godhead Himself, God Almighty Himself, the ruler of the universe Himself, the maker of heaven and earth, is now stuffed in the body of clay. He's stuffed in you and I. Who will have wondered that God Almighty, the one who sits in the throne of heaven, the one that the elders, the 24 elders bow down to, who will have thought that God Almighty, who brought the world forth by the breath of His power, who will have thought that God Almighty will stoop down to our level and come and dwell in the body of clay? Who would have thought that? But oh, my friends, God uses the base things of this world to confound the wise. God chooses things that are seemingly not great to make greatness, His greatness and His glory to be displayed for the world to see. So the blessings of God is for you in the place called there. The blessings of God is in the place for you called there. The place called there might not be spectacular. The place called there might not be a place that is so great. Because when you look at this widow, God uses the widow. How come God didn't send Elijah to a place where there's a palace? How come He didn't send Elijah to a place where they already have more than enough? That blesses me. Really? God sent Elijah to a place where the money is not enough, where they didn't have enough to eat themselves. Why? Because God also chose to bless the woman. As the woman obeyed Elijah, something began to happen in her household. Her abundance began to flow. I don't know about you. When somebody had the last cross of oil to use, and they had to yield that cross of oil to the Lord began to bless it. I don't know how you can think about it. When you wake up in the morning, the woman will be thinking, hey, maybe the last one is coming today. And she goes in there. So the cross of oil is already filled. The flour is already filled up. How did that happen? Because the God who made heavens and earth is the one who is the provider. Oh yes, has the vision been given to you and you think it's so big? I'm here to tell you, as you're going from here to a place called there, the Lord who gave the vision has made the provision available already. Your job and my job is to stand up, arise just like Elijah, get you up now, begin to go to the place called there, because your blessing is in the place called there. As you obey the Father, as you obey what He's asked you to do, the blessing of God is over your life. It's over your life in the place called there. Don't give up and don't give in. Don't think it cannot be done. No way. You are destined for success. You are destined for greatness. God God has called you by his name. You are his, and therefore your miracle is on the way. Now remember, there's a responsibility on your part. Your part is to listen. Your part is to act. Don't spend all day praying in tongues and not acting. Don't spend all days, reading the Bible and don't go and trade. Don't spend all days doing stuff that you're meant to do and you're doing the wrong thing at the wrong time. No, do what you got to do, but trust God for the result. So obedience is our part in getting to the place called there. No, the place called there is the place that also requires work. The place called there requires work. All right, because if Elijah did not stand up, he would have died at the brook of Cherith. If he hadn't obeyed what God has said, he would have died in the brook of Cherith. And he would have said, oh, but he's a man of God. Yeah, he's a man of God, but he wasn't listening. You see, because God makes provision available for us, and God delivers us from the evil one. So therefore, now our job in this matter is to listen and pay attention to the one who has called us to the vision. So now when he says, I want you to go to a place called there, we need to know that in the place called there, that's where our blessing is. Our blessings are there in the place called there. So now Elijah rose up and he went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow was there gathering sticks. And he called her, and said, fetch me, I pray you, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. It's amazing to me that Elijah, the first thing Elijah asked for again was water. If you go back to the first one we read about in the brook Cherith, Elijah got to the brook Cherith and he had water to drink. Then the ravens came and began to feed him the flesh and the bread. So which means that Elijah again requires what? He requires the water to quench his thirst. That's why the Bible says, out of your belly shall flows what? Rivers of living water. As we are connected to the Holy Spirit, we have more than enough. So, but Elijah also identified the woman. I don't know how that happened. If the Lord told him and said, go to Zarephath, surely the Lord will tell him, that's the woman, now go and meet her. That's the woman, now go and meet her. Now, it's important that the Lord also commanded the woman. Now, this woman here, is not really somebody that the Bible talks a lot about prior to now. But it says there's a widow in Zarephath. No wonder, in the book of Matthew, Jesus Christ was saying that, during the days of the drought of Elijah, there were many widows in the land of Israel, but none was Elijah sent to apart from the widow in Zarephath. So which means God chose this woman as an instrument of blessing. God also want to bless her. God also want to make her to be a blessing to Elijah. So God selected this woman to be an instrument of blessing, and the woman obeyed. Because she obeyed, the instruction of the Lord, there was a connection. Tonight I prophesy that every destiny helper that you need to take you to what God has ordained for you, the Lord begins to connect you with them in the name of Jesus. My prayer for you tonight is that every destiny helper that the Lord has chosen, ordained, prepared before the vision that is given to you even came to your heart, that there will be a connection. There will be a connection, a path crossing in the name of Jesus Christ. So tonight as we go, what I want you to ponder on is there is a place called there for you and I. That is the place where the blessing is. But I have a responsibility that while I'm waiting, while I'm going, that I'm listening and hearing instruction clearly from the Father. So tonight as we go, I want us to pray. Father, Lord, we thank you. Father, Lord, we bless you. We thank you for your goodness and your kindness and your mercies. Thank you that we have a place called there for us. In the transition and going through life, there's a place called there. Every helper that we need, Lord, we thank you that they have been made available. We walk and we connect with them now in the name of Jesus. Everyone that you've ordained to help us in taking us to the place you've chosen, Lord. Father, we receive their help now by faith in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Almighty God, that our ears are listening to what you have to say. Lord, we thank you, Almighty God, that our heart is open. Our hearts are open to hear what you have to say in the name of Jesus. Thank you that your people, Almighty God, will take responsibility, that we will all take responsibility to do what we have to do when we have to do it. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for being our good Father. We give you praise and we worship you. Thank you that everything that pertains to life and godliness, you have already given to us already. May our heart receive knowledge and wisdom and understanding in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We give you praise and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. All right, so have a wonderful night. And again, thank you very much for joining. I will speak to you another time.